Welcome to the World Football Summit podcast, the show for football industry leaders who want to stay ahead of the game. We bring you the latest insights, trends, and stories from the experts driving innovation and progress in sports business worldwide. Join us as we dive deep into the ideas and initiatives transforming the world of football. From sustainability and innovation to player development, fan engagement, and everything in between. Our goal is to unite the global football industry and drive positive change and progress.
Hey guys, welcome to a special episode of the World Football Summit podcast. I'm your host, Jaime, CMO at World Football Summit. Today, we go deep into the world of maximizing stadium revenues as we bring you a panel I had the opportunity to moderate during Football Innovation Forum. I was joined by two remarkable guests who are at the forefront of revolutionizing the fan experience and driving revenue growth in the sports industry. Milos Nenadovic, representing LaLiga, brings us insights from a league that this season has seen a remarkable 10% increase in attendance compared to pre-pandemic levels. And we also had Juan Antón de Salas from Villarreal CF, a club that has recently undergone an impressive stadium renovation and has established itself as one of the top 40 clubs with highest fan value globally. By the way, remember, Juan was a previous guest on the podcast for episode 29, and I highly suggest you check that out. The three of us talked about the strategies and innovations that have contributed to their success and discussed the role of stadiums in captivating the interest of non-traditional sports fans in a highly competitive entertainment landscape. Talk about how stadium experiences contribute to the competitive positioning of football clubs and leagues. Then, to engage new market segments, how can organizations like Villarreal and leagues like La Liga attract those audiences who are not actively engaged in sports? With the rise of digital platforms and remote viewing options, how can stadiums maintain their relevance in the evolving sports business landscape? What challenges do they face, and what strategies are being employed to overcome them? How can football clubs optimize return on stadium investments through service diversification? What are the examples of new revenue streams within stadiums that have enhanced the matchday experience and increased revenues? And how is data and KPIs being used across football clubs to measure success of new initiatives in the stadium? This is just a glimpse of the insightful conversation we had, which was tremendously fun. But before we jump into the episode, we want to remind you that World Football Summit Europe is just around the corner on September 20th and 21st. Don't miss out on the opportunity to help shape the future of football. Head over to www.worldfootballsummit.com and buy your ticket right now. Again, that's www.worldfootballsummit.com. And remember, you can also subscribe to our newsletter, where we share the latest insights, updates, and trends in the industry, as well as all of what goes on across our events. Find the link in the show notes. And now, get ready to join us as we dive deep into the future of football stadiums, sustainability measures, data utilization, community impact, and so much more. Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. Yes. Really looking forward to this. Before jumping into the conversation, which I think is going to be very interesting, I want to introduce with a little bit of data just to give context to the panel. So according to Deloitte, to their Money League report, when you look at the top 20 clubs, it's 15% of their revenue comes from matchday activities, 44% comes from broadcasting, and 41% from commercial revenues. And this is a similar split to the one that was seen before the pandemic. But I would argue the value of the stadium, it's much greater, especially because it has a lot of intangible benefits. So today it's really nice to have the opportunity to speak with Juan from Villarreal. They're doing an amazing job. They just renovated their stadium. And of course, from Milos, from La Liga, attendance is 10% higher than before the pandemic. So obviously the work at La Liga has been amazing as well, no? Guys, welcome to Football Innovation Forum. Milos, I want to start with a question. So basically, there's been a lot of evolution in terms of the entertainment landscape over the recent years, you know, especially because of the emergence of digital platforms. So you have a lot of options for fans. Now, in that sense, how does the stadium experience contribute to, let's say, or help sports clubs differentiate among all the different entertainment options that we have available?
Well, first of all, Thank you for the invite, and it's always a pleasure to be in Istanbul, in Turkey. It's a lovely, lovely place to visit. To answer your question, what we need to focus on first and foremost is that our competition as stadiums, as football clubs, is not simply other football clubs or other sports. Our competition is every single entertainment option out there. Bars, restaurants, theaters, cafes, even staying at home and watching Netflix is our competition. So what we need to do as stadiums in order to keep up is provide answers that each and every one of our customers needs and desires. So if you want to have a workout, go to the gym, do it at the stadium. If you want to host a party, you should do it at the stadium. Want to have a nice meal, do it at the stadium. The stadium should become an entertainment center for the city. And this is our biggest challenge, to make the public understand that stadiums are not something that you go to every 2 weeks to watch a football game. It's an arena, a venue where the opportunities you have are, let's say, limitless, but they can answer your questions as a client. And this is the way in which we need to work forward with our clubs in order for them first to teach the market and to answer the market's questions, and then later create products that answer those questions.
Okay. Well, thank you for that, because it's a perfect segue to my next question for you, Juan. Eventually, football clubs to grow, they need to tap into new segments beyond the traditional football fan. So how do clubs like Villarreal or even LaLiga do this? How do they tap into other fans and let them understand that, hey, this is an entertainment consideration that I need to have in mind?
Well, again, thank you. Thank you for having me, you know, and for your consideration to my club and taking the lead of Milos' speech. Obviously, we tap out because we couldn't be more on the same page with LaLiga, meaning for us, the centerpiece of our commercial strategy as of today is enhancing the stadium, you know? So this is key for us in a place like Villarreal, because if you guys know our city, we only have 50,000 people, population, and out of these 50,000, 12,000 are already season ticket holders. So it's really, really hard to tap deeper into our local audience. So we are attracting more and more people by, you know, connecting to all the tourists that are coming over. You know, our region, the region of Valencia, is very, very touristic. So we are trying to enhance every single aspect of the stadium to have what we say life around the stadium every single day, right? Mm-hmm. So how are we doing this? Well, this has been scaling up since a couple of years ago with the lead of La Liga, trying to, you know, empower every single venue in La Liga. You know, we said, okay, this is the moment to do renovation in the stadium, to have new works, to have new spaces. And we totally got it from the very beginning, and we jumped on that. And luckily for us, now we have our renovated stadium, mm-hmm. and we're good to go in order to tap into other markets and stuff.
If you guys want to learn more about this, we actually had a conversation, Juan and I, on the World Football Summit podcast about this, and he goes into much greater detail. And I also suggest that you guys see the video that they have on the website, because it's really impressive how the stadium ended up. Now, Milos, going back to you, we were mentioning before, no, there's so many options available. Now, with all of this in mind, what are some challenges that the clubs at La Liga are facing to keep being relevant within the vast options that you have from an entertainment perspective?
Well, first thing to understand here is that you cannot control what's going to happen on the pitch. So the quality of your product is what it is. That's something that's outside your control. What you do control is everything around that experience. And this is our challenge. In order for that experience, from when you buy a ticket, when you to your access control, to your circulation, to your F&B options, to your seat comfort, to your egress, that everything is catered to the customer's need. And our challenge is finding a way for each customer segment or each group to have that optimal experience, because other options have figured it out. And when you go to a restaurant or when you go to a bar, your experience is more or less streamlined in a certain way. In football stadiums, it's at least up to this moment has been a more of a discovery process where a fan needs to figure out on their own where the toilets are, where the food stands are, where is my hospitality area. This is the kind of challenge that we have in order to, well, first of all, increase our customer spend, and then second of all, have more customers of different types of groups or different segments enter into our stadiums and have more engagement with us. So the challenges are really in those fine details and creating and catering an experience specifically to a client, because if you do not do that, the sport itself is not enough. I mean, if there were enough football fans to fill every arena, every stadium in the world, none of us would be here because it would be pointless. Mm-hmm. Because there are not, we need to cater to those marginal sports groups and to make them, make sure that they have a reason to go inside our stadium.
In that sense, and we'll try to get into it later to see how clubs are using data to kind of segment and graze those segments that you're mentioning. But before getting into that, we cannot avoid the fact that renovating a stadium and having an optimal experience and having multiple options, it's a big commitment. You know, it's a lot of resources that the clubs need to invest. And of course, there's pressure to maximize the return on investment, right? So going into a little bit more detail on what you were mentioning, Juan, how are clubs like Villarreal doing this? How are they identifying new sources of revenue that are going to help them achieve or maximize return on investment of a renovated stadium like Ceramica?
Well, you know, in our approach, everything is really connected, right? So in our case, in the commercial department, we are trying to invent new assets every single year, new marketing opportunities, new sponsorship. Ideally for us, you know, being La Liga such an international property, is to reach out to international markets, such as the Turkish market, and to have companies coming over, right? So either we had a venue that was fit up and running, and it was excellent with the spaces, with catering opportunities, with, you know, the approach, the personal approach for these companies, or we are not going to be able to grow on the marketing side. So I could consider the stadium as a business that has a break-even target, you know, but it's helping me grow in every single other area. You know, for example, Villarreal has engaged in an international project with international academies, you know. For me, to be able to offer these international academies even the opportunity to play in the stadium, meaning the season is over, I have maybe probably two good months of utilizing the stadium for football purposes, not concerts, that's another story, but puristically, the approach in football, that gives me a lot of selling stuff, okay. You know? Mm-hmm. I mean, for me, strategically, the fact that I'm able to offer restaurant spaces, a different approach to these companies, to these students, these players that can come over and feel that the bridge between whatever they are and Villarreal is true, mm-hmm. and it's true in the stadium sense, mm-hmm. that's fantastic.
At the end of the day, it's all connected, if you think mm-hmm. about it. Now it's analyzing the segments, as Milos was saying before, and then generating new services that target specifically to those segments. And that's the challenge, obviously. No, but the reality is, Milos, and of course, feel free if you want to add anything there. If not, I'll just jump to the next question, because I was thinking about this and say, hey, it is true the experience at this stadium, it's a physical one, but we cannot avoid the fact that we live in a hybrid world. You know, we have a digital experience and a physical experience. No, so how do clubs at La Liga work, you know, to combine both worlds, if you will? How are those, you know, is there anything that La Liga is testing?
Yeah, well, it would be, again, first of all, it would be great if the physical experience was enough, right? But we're no longer in a world where that's the case, where every generation needs to have a digital experience at the stadium. We would start off by thinking, at least in the earlier years, okay, let's create digital experiences for the millennials and now for Gen Z. But we're seeing that every generation across the whole spectrum needs a digital experience. And what we're starting to work with is, again, here, the main concept being customer service. What we're starting to work with, first of all, is facial recognition software, for example, for entering into the arena. So you don't have to use a ticket. You can just come in and have your face scanned and that's it. You're good to go. We're working with optimization of the food delivery and quick pickup systems, right? We've had these software in place for about 5 or 6 years already in some of the stadiums. And we found that it creates a lot of bottlenecks because, well, in a system where you have 30, 40, 50,000 people, a lot of, let's say, lead time can be wasted. A lot of bottlenecks can be created by people using software at the same time. So we're kind of trying to figure out in which zones to use pickups and which zones to use delivery, how those two can work together logistically in order to reduce wait times, reduce bottlenecks, reduce queues, so that our clubs and our clubs' clients have, let's say, more time to watch the game, but are also incentivized to increase their spend. And then what we really want to get into at the end of the day is also heat mapping.
Okay.
So to understand how circulation is flowing, and we're trying to do studies on that, in order to connect them to digital spaces or digital channels, they can tell you, don't go to bar B because there's a lot of people right there. Go to bar C because that one's empty. Or toilets X are really crowded right now, but toilets Z are quite empty. You should go to that one. That's kind of the next step of our evolution.
What I take away from that is that at the end of the day, you're trying to reduce friction, right?
So exactly.
Basically, you know, make the experience as the flow as seamlessly as possible. And obviously, we've all been at the stadium, right? There's always, you know, places where it's more jammed, to your point, or there's, you know, whatever issue. I think that digital component is going to help the fan have, you know, this, I'm going to watch my game, I'm going to have the best experience possible, and then I'm just going to enjoy.
We control the experience that our customer has. So we need to do the best that we can in order for him to have no reason to have any negative comments at all.
Mm-hmm. And Juan, let's take this out of the stadium, because to me, I think the stadium has a bit potential. It already does. To be, you know, a centerpiece of the local culture at the end of the day. It's not just the football match, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I think Villarreal is a good example and you can correct me on the data here, but I think it's 50,000 people live in Villarreal, and I think it's like about, you guys have like season ticket holders is like 25,000. So it's pretty much more or less half the city. Effectively, this means that the stadium has the potential to become, you know, part and influence the local culture, and you have a strong tie to your community. So how are you doing this? How are you maximizing the opportunities that you get from being a cultural reference?
Well, you know, if you guys come and visit Villarreal, you'll see it's, like you say, it's a pretty small village, and football is the center of life in Villarreal. We are in an economic cluster that's very powerful in terms of the ceramic production in Spain. So we have a lot of corporate support.
Mm-hmm.
And that is actually the initial phase of what's driving the life around stadium, right? There's a lot of salesmen of all these different ceramic groups that are supporting the team, that are bringing either their clients or people over. With the renovation of the stadium, we've managed to attract tourists, you know, uh-huh. because everywhere around Villarreal is pretty touristic, pretty awesome, to be honest. The uh-huh. beach in Valencia and Castellón, that's an amazing place to be, right?
Yeah.
And well, for us, I was going to say, listening to Milos and all these amazing developments, that we are, we'll jump into that when they have it ready for us. That would be awesome. But for us, like you said, most of the stadium is filled with season ticket holders that are traditional, coming from, you know, maybe 20 years supporting the team. And like I say, if the stadium fits 24,000, 2,500 seats are reserved for the away fans. And we have 20,500 season ticket holders. So this leaves a gap of maybe 1,000 tickets to sell.
Okay.
But that's the only thing we need to sell, right?
Uh-huh.
And we're using this to engage with people in many different ways. But what we're focusing on is to enhance the experience with the pre-experience of the stadium.
Okay.
Meaning, for me, it is very important, as of today, a team like us that has a lot of corporate support, maybe it's the same case for other clubs, to be able to give my sponsors or my partners the opportunity to have a very flawless, seamless communication with the club. So we're investing in technology that is helping me, just the fact of spreading the tickets out, you know? Just the fact of personalizing their experience for the, you know, to prepare for the real experience, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then the more data, the more information they have of our stadium, being a smaller venue, you know, I think Villarreal is a perfect showcase and inspiration for other small-sized clubs, you know, like us, like with a reasonable investment, you can have a reasonable stadium going on. We'll jump into higher technology and be able to have all this circuit, you know, flowing and thriving.
That's a good point. I think, 2 points for what you just said, or at least that I take away. One, the match experience starts way before the experience. So, you know, you have to effectively keep engaging fans, you know, at a certain time, at a certain point before. But also, how do you keep that flow going, correct? So make them want to return, make them want to spread the word that the experience at the stadium is fantastic and that you have to go. So just keep that circle turning and turning, right? And since now we're, let's say, taking things out of the stadium, Milos, I also want to, you know, raise the point that maybe revenues don't only have to come from the stadium. I think a lot of clubs have a lot of facilities, a lot of venues. You have your training grounds, right? So just to give that example. So how are clubs working with this? How are they generating revenues from venues or facilities that are not the stadium per se?
Well, one of our main challenges in La Liga, and specifically the La Liga Impulso project, is to monetize and to commercialize training grounds. Because what we've seen, and rightfully so, within the La Liga Impulso project is that many clubs are modernizing their training grounds to be on the top level in on the continent. But with that modernization and the investment that we talked about in the stadium comes the need to then monetize that investment to let's say, to make it profitable or as profitable as possible. And that's where we, with the Impulso project, come in. We have, as a first challenge, trying to make the, first of all, clubs, and the second of all, the public, see the training ground as a potential commercial area. And there's two main ways to do that. There's one called, let's say, a more service way, because a lot of training grounds are usually located outside of the city or a periphery or an industrial area. So the service way to make it as profitable as possible is to provide service to those areas. People who either work on or live in those either rural areas or industrial areas, they need somewhere to eat lunch. Mm-hmm. They need somewhere to go to the gym. Well, for example, those areas are something the basics for you already have at your training ground, or you're already developing at your training ground. So all you need to do is extend them to the general public that's in the area, and you have businesses that can flow on their own. On the other side, we have experiences and events. Mm-hmm. So just like we try to focus on monetizing the non-match day aspect of stadiums, it's the same thing for training grounds. There's B2B and B2C events you can do. If you want to do, let's say, team building for a company, you can do it at the training ground. If you want to organize a party or a wedding or a birthday, you can do it at the training ground. If you want to have a boot camp of fitness or do a 5K, 10K race, organize it around the training ground. All these micro events, they're not going to break the bank, right? Mm-hmm. But each one of those, if commercialized, and which is what we're trying to do, is going to bring more and more notoriety in a positive way to the training ground and make the public see it as a space that you can potentially use to answer your questions.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's a good point. I think that what effectively demonstrates is that football clubs are becoming entertainment hubs, if you will. Not only through the stadium, but through everything that they have to offer, every single touch point they could offer to the fan. And I like that concept of micro events. You don't have to think, you know, big or you know, think about disruptive things. It's just, you know, at different mini events that are going to help improve the overall experience, no? Now, Juan, you and I once had a conversation and you told me that you had KPIs for everything and that you measure everything. So yeah, we're talking a lot about ideas and, you know, and how do we improve the fan experience. But what are the measures of success? Is it just revenue, or are you looking at other KPIs to prove the success of whatever strategies that you do?
That's a very good one. We have KPIs for everything. And our heritage, industrial heritage, is to continuously improve. I told you about this. And we look into every single detail. But I would say that we're still building these KPIs, you know. If we're talking in the stadium business, for me, it is very, very important to scale up. You know, our project is very reasonable. I mean, we try to comply with everything La Liga is offering to all the venues, but we know we are fighting in a league that we have a stadium of 24,000 people and that the density of population is a certain amount. So what I'm looking here is if the restaurant is getting, you know, the amount of people to be profitable business, maybe in just 1 year, you know, mm-hmm. getting a customer base that's allowing me to jump to restaurant number two and just restaurant number three in this second phase of opportunity. If I'm reaching out to the community and I'm getting listed, you know, everywhere to have events going on, we just hosted an event for the local police, you know,
okay.
Meaning the micro events are a fantastic solution. Everybody, if you want to feel connection with your football club, why not, you know, open up to every single thing, you know, and we are looking into the basically the commercial KPIs at the moment, you know, of the communication with the local companies, the local community and everything. And regarding what you were saying before about the training grounds, I would say this is the huge connection with the stadium that in our case is quite simple because they are only 5 minutes distance from the stadium to the to the training grounds. But we are even redesigning the entries and the access levels. So our training grounds are a very, very accessible part of the town, you know, for you to visit. And these are KPIs that I'm looking into, you know, the amount of visitors, because our training grounds are probably the hottest spot during a weekend, you know, in the area. So there's so many, many things that we can do around this, you know.
There's so much opportunity. And the more you analyze, I guess, more insights that you're going to be able to get and more strategies that you're going to be able to implement. No? At the end of the day, it's a circle, no? So now you mentioned, Juan, the sponsors and creating a similar or a seamless experience for them as well. And Milos, I want to ask you, because what are the opportunities that you see for sponsors, partners to be involved in this new, call it, landscape when we need to evolve the fan experience in the stadium?
Well, I think traditionally speaking, the sponsors' playing ground has always been hospitality. And that's not going to change. And Juan touched on a very important topic, which is the relationship you have with your partners, where you feel like you're working together towards a common goal, that they feel part of your club and you feel a part of their organization. And this is the only way that you can, let's say, involve them more. So for example, what we're doing with certain clubs is that partners are being involved in the process of designing hospitality spaces and designing the hospitality program. Because at the end of the day, they are also profiting from it. They are associating themselves to our brand, to our club's brand, because they want to do business with other people who are in those spaces. So who best to advise us on how to proportionize the space that we have than the actual people who will be using it? And once a partner feels that they are involved in the process, that you are like VRL's partners, that you're designing projects together, then that partner is much more likely to have a long-term committed relationship with you because they have skin in the game.
Okay. And going into the club perspective, Juan, how does it make it easier, for example, when you have a renovated stadium to target sponsors? Are you able to, or have you been able to change in a way, or have you seen an evolution of how you're targeting sponsors to attract them to the club?
100%. Carrying on with what Milos is saying, just because we are listening, we have a thermometer and we're, you know, I mean, for us, the corporate support is really, really strong. You know, I remember 20 years ago, when there were not so many corporate skyboxes in Spain, we already had 50, you know, and other neighbors might have only had a few of them, you know. And listening to them and what they really need has been, you know, mandatory for us in able to redesign everything. For me, to have the renovated stadium makes a huge difference, you know, because I can tap into different markets now. Regional sponsorships is key for all LaLiga clubs. And if I couldn't cater the experience for all these international companies, why would they be interested in Villarreal? They are just buying advertising space. I need the connection. I need the engagement, the emotional, you know, relationship that we could build. That's the biggest asset we have in Villarreal. You know it. I mean, we are so accessible. Yeah. I mean, it's bad for me to say it, but we're a bunch of nice people, you know, if you come over. So we can create really easily emotional connections. So for me, having the renovated stadium, it's like, hey, I have a big flag now. You know, I'm waving the flag and I'm being able to attract bigger and wider sponsors.
Yeah, I think the key point for me there is that Villarreal, in this case, is a club it's easy to resonate with in terms of their values, in terms of the impact they have the community, you know, at the end of the day. And that helps overall the experience and to attract sponsors, right? Now, Milos, given your experience and your view of other clubs, not only in La Liga, but, you know, in other leagues, which I'm sure you're looking into, are there any innovative examples or any that you would highlight in terms of how they're maximizing the opportunities that come from the stadium?
Well, we can separate that into match day and non-match day. On the match day side, I mean, first of all, I will give a shout out to Villarreal, for example, because their F&B space, the restaurants, are a great example of how to solve one of the bigger issues that we had in Spanish football, which is the amount of time that people spend at the stadium. Let's say the tradition is that you come 5 minutes before the game, you have a drink and eat somewhere else, you come for the football and you leave. Villarreal is creating restaurant spaces at the stadium that you can go to before the game, spend time and money at the stadium. That means you're spending there more time, you're more open to other club products, and you're there at the stadium right when the game begins. So this is a great way in order to have people at your arena or at your stadium for a longer time and increase their spend. Other clubs in Spain have an options to do different types of experiences. Like, for example, one of the best ones is Levante, who has, I think, 6 or 7 different match day experiences, from the ball boys to the game day birthdays to the walking on the pitch to the shootout on the pitch experience. All kind of things you can, like a menu on the restaurant, choose and add on top of your ticket. Real Celta, for example, is a great example of a club that uses every nook and cranny of their stadium, however small and however isolated it may be, to create a different kind of experience, hospitality or not. Then non-match day, I mean, you have all types of events that, like Juan said, they're micro events. Like the macro events, let's not focus ourselves with, because those bigger ones like concerts or conferences, you're going to get 3 or 4 of those a year and not more. That's not sustainable in the long run. The smaller ones are. So Sevilla, for example, has a whole division dedicated to events, Sevilla FC events. They do birthday parties, they do weddings, they do a Christmas party at the stadium. They do smaller events for companies. Or you have Espanyol as well, who organizes different small events for local companies, for local support groups. And then you have outside of Spain, there's great examples in the Benelux countries specifically of clubs using the stadium as a workout center. The actual, for example, the actual stands, the stairs, the design of the stadium is your workout, for example. Or in Switzerland, which is a very, let's say, commercial area, there's a lot of examples of using, like I said before, team buildings. At the stadium, you use certain rooms, certain spaces, and the grass itself to create different types of team building exercises. And all of these are events that are not very big on their own, but summed together, they create, firstly, a social mass that follows the club, and secondly, they add to your P&L.
They create an overall brand experience. Listening to all the examples that you said, I was just thinking about, this is no different than, for example, when I go to the same supermarket every time. I always have my experience within my local supermarket, and every single touch point is going to build my overall experience with that brand. At the end of the day, this is the same. If every experience that I have at the stadium with the club that I'm supporting, it's going to help create a more or a stronger relationship with the club as well, right?
Yes.
And you were mentioning a lot of examples there, and we told the audience, Juan, that we might go back to the use of data and how you guys are using data, because it's such a key topic. Really understand the different segments that one can create. Now, I don't know if you can go into, and we've touched upon a lot of examples, but how do you work that identification of fans based on the data to offer them tailored, let's say, experiences? Are you doing something like that at Villarreal?
We are currently, I mean, this is a project that has been ongoing for a while. You know, we're currently improving our CRM. And the fact that we wanted to introduce a gamification process into this, in our case, is interesting because obviously us, we have a very, very pure football approach. If you ask me how do we gamify something, maybe it's just by bringing people over to the under-23s, to the under-21s, to the ladies team, to engage with these kind of teams and everything. So we need to focus and to build a very robust CRM that allows us to know, to have this constant communication with fans. We very keen into asking them what they think about the season, what they think about their current state of their membership and all this kind of stuff. So we're focusing on that part now, you know, to have everything in place, to have, again, a seamless, either via the app or via whatever they are interacting with the club. So it's effortless for them to give us their opinion, you know, or to, I want to know how many season ticket holders are dog lovers, you know, just to customize all the rest of the experience. Because then again, the trend, and everybody here knows, is that the sponsorships are more and more based on the database, you know? And we don't want to sell data like just nothing. You know, data is a very important privacy factor. You know, we respect the lives of our season ticket holders. So we want to do this together with them. You know, what do you want to share with us? The more we know, the better for your club, actually, to be honest. And this is how we're building this connection with the data, which is also a big challenge.
at the end is what we were mentioning before with Milos, no? Trying to reduce friction, using the data to create more tailored experiences that are going to reduce friction and going to improve the overall fan experience, no? Well, Milos, Juan, I want to thank you because I think we got into a lot of practical details and example that I think the audience can pick up a few ideas to develop on their own. But I don't want to let you go without thinking or asking you both one question, one final question from my end. Let's look 5 to 10 years down the line. So are there any, call it technologies, innovations, or whatever you want to frame it, that are going to impact the fan experience of the football stadium or the experience at the stadium in the future?
Well, I mean, that technology maybe hasn't even been invented yet, so it's a bit of a tricky answer, but I look forward to a time where I can go to a football stadium as a client and not have to get my hands out of my pockets.
Okay.
So I look forward to a time where I don't need to show my ticket at any point. I don't need to show my credit card I have it on my phone, but I don't need to get my phone out of my pocket mm-hmm. to pay for a beer or to pay for a sandwich. I don't need to think about where my seat is. I don't need to think about where the bars are. And this kind of contactless technology, which is infused with artificial intelligence that will tell you where to go and what to do, this is what's going to make the biggest change in a customer's experience inside the stadium. So, you know, this is starting to happen. We're doing facial recognition to enter the stadium already. In the States, they're already doing, well, with the Amazon innovations and Whole Foods, they're already doing automatic checkout where you don't need to pay for the things you buy. Once that gets more integrated into the overall sports landscape, I can essentially go to a football game or to any sports event and just from the street, just go to my seat and that's it. Mm-hmm. That's what you want. You want to have an experience that's completely unbothered.
Okay. Fine.
Yeah, well, he answered for both of us. That's amazing. I mean, in my case, and going back to maybe the human touch, I would love to have, you know, a time when the stadium is always full because the connection between the fans is so strong, you know, that, I mean, we actually encourage, you know, if you're not coming over to the stadium, please lend your season ticket to a family member or to somebody mm-hmm. because we want the stadium to look super good. I mean, the more people, the merrier. We've renovated the stadium, but we took out some seats to have a more comfortable experience. So if in 10 years from now, the stadium is always full, just because the connectivity is so strong, you know, everybody knows what's happening, no friction, everybody's coming, or everybody has lent a season ticket to somebody else, that would be awesome, you know? I mean, to have the human connection, which is the most important part for me, you know, thriving around the stadium, the city, but for us Spaniards, football is a very, very important part of our lives, you know? Something like this.
I think football also here in Turkey is a big part of people's lives. And I agree. I think, and guys, I'm sorry, but I just think it's important that you guys stay with the concept of reducing friction. And that's kind of like the key of what I took out from this conversation. At the end of the day, if we want to maximize the revenues coming from the stadium and have an optimal fan experience, we need to make efforts as football clubs to reduce the friction of the fan and have them have a seamless experience at the club using data, targeting them with specific services that are going to be really tailored to what I'm looking for as a fan. And if you think about it, this is something that the fan is seeing all over, not only in football. And it's easy for them to compare. I think we also need to take that outside look and say, hey, this is what's happening in the world. All the services I'm going into, they're reducing friction. And this is, where I think where we're headed. So, Milos, Juan, I want to thank you. I hope the audience learned a lot. I did. And I want to thank you for the opportunity of joining me in this panel. And thank you to all who stayed in the panel and hope you enjoyed. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And there you have them. Milos Nenadovic from La Liga and Juan Antón de Salas from Villarreal with a masterclass on what is needed to maximize stadium revenues. What were the main takeaways I took from this amazing panel? First, reducing friction is key. Is your club aiming to deliver seamless fan experiences in the stadium? After all, the stadium enables sports to differentiate from other forms of entertainment. Second, leverage data for fan segmentation. This paves the way for clubs to venture beyond football by crafting personalized experiences. And finally, crafting a sports brand experience is a blend of micro-events within the stadium. Did anything else stand out to you? Let us know on social media. Don't forget to subscribe and rate the podcast on your platform of choice and share it with your industry colleagues. Thank you for tuning into this special episode of the World Football Summit podcast. We hope you enjoyed it. Have a great rest of your day, and we hope to see you next time.